In the previous video, we introduced the essential concepts of longitudinal waves using this animation of a sound wave passing through the air. And in this video, we're deriving the wave function for the sound pressure as a function of position and time, and we're going to get a relationship between displacement amplitude and pressure amplitude and work a related example. So we've highlighted one particular line of air molecules in this animation, and we see that it moves back and forth sinusoidally as the longitudinal wave passes through. The amplitude of that oscillation is called the displacement amplitude at that particular value of x, where x is the equilibrium position of that white line. And note that the displacement amplitude A is half the width of the double arrow in the picture. It's the distance from the equilibrium position x to either one of the extreme positions of our white line, left or right of equilibrium. So then we can write down a displacement function, and that's y of x and t is equal to a cosine kx minus omega t, describing the sinusoidal motion of that white line about its equilibrium position x. But for other values of x, it describes the sinusoidal motion of the other lines about their equilibrium positions. This is a little bit tricky because locating this white line means an x value along the wave picking out the equilibrium position of the line. But then the oscillations about that position are also horizontal. So y here is telling us a horizontal displacement from the equilibrium horizontal position. And again, y of x and t is describing horizontal oscillations about that point. Note that when we look at this equation for the wave function, we can get an intuition for it by imagining a fixed x value, and then we see that the displacement will oscillate sinusoidally with time, or we can imagine a fixed t value, a snapshot in time, and we get sinusoidal oscillations in space, meaning that as we go from left to right, the displacement values of successive lines are constantly changing according to a cosine function, leading to these regions of compression and rarefaction in the wave. So now that we have a basic idea of what this displacement function is doing, we get to the main goal of this video, and that's deriving a formula for the pressure as a function of position and time. In other words, we want to relate the displacement wave to the pressure wave. So to get our derivation done, it's useful to change the style of our diagram and look at the sound wave passing through a three-dimensional column of air. So we start with the undisturbed column of air just sitting there at atmospheric pressure, and we've labeled two positions in that. There's x on the left and x plus delta x on the right. Now, when the sound wave passes through this column, the air at each of those positions will oscillate according to a displacement function y of x and t, so that at any moment in time, the displacement is different for those two original positions. And that means the original volume between the molecules on the left and the molecules on the right has changed. So we see in the picture that the molecules originally at x have been displaced to the right by some amount y of x and t, and the molecules originally at x plus delta x have been displaced by some other amount y of x plus delta x and t. And the picture makes it clear that the displacement of the molecules that started on the right end is less than the displacement of the molecules that started on the left end. And that means the original volume of air between those two points has been compressed. And that was just an arbitrary choice I had to make in order to draw a picture. So again, the goal is to get some kind of connection between the displacement wave and the pressure wave. And that brings us back to the relationship between pressure change and volume change, which is mediated by a property called the bulk modulus. And that's the capital B in the equation there. And I'll post a link at the top to the video I did yesterday to review the idea of elastic moduli and the bulk modulus in particular. But basically, the bulk modulus tells you about the compressibility of the medium, or compressibility of air in this case. So this equation tells us how much the pressure will rise when a volume of air is compressed relative to the atmospheric pressure that was there before the sound wave arrived. And we can see in the picture that this volume is indeed compressed, just because y of x plus delta x t happens to be smaller than y of x t at this particular moment. So our delta v is going to be a change in length times the cross-sectional area. And the change of length can be accounted for by just taking the difference of those two y displacements. Note that inside those brackets, we're going to get a negative number at this particular moment in time that we're looking at in the picture, because again, that y of x plus delta x t is less than the y of x t. That means we get a positive result on the right-hand side of our equation, and that makes sense because our pressure should be increasing over there on the left side of the equation if we're compressing our original volume. So there's our delta V up there in the numerator. Again, just the difference in the horizontal displacements at each end of the cylinder multiplied by the cross-sectional area. And then in the denominator, we have the original volume of that cylinder of air molecules, and that's just cross-sectional area times the original length, which was delta X. Now the A's cancel out, and now in that fraction, I see something really familiar. I see the value of a function evaluated at X plus delta X, minus the value of that function evaluated at X, all divided by delta X. When we take the limit as delta X becomes arbitrarily small, that's an X derivative. In other words, the thing we're looking at there is the partial derivative of the wave function with respect to X. Now, one tricky point about this derivation is the delta P. That's the pressure on this compressed thin slice of air minus the original atmospheric pressure before the sound wave arrived. Well, we're going to work in gauge pressure here. In other words, counting atmospheric pressure as zero. So delta P is really just the gauge pressure, and we've already taken the limit as delta X becomes small, so that gauge pressure is the pressure at a location of X. So we can write that P of X and T is equal to the negative of the bulk modulus times the X partial of the wave function Y. Now recall that that original wave function describing the displacement as a function of position and time, that's A cosine KX minus omega T. And if we take the X partial of that, that means we have to differentiate the cosine function, and that gives us a negative sine function. And then the chain rule produces a factor of K. So that X partial is going to be a negative AK sine KX minus omega T. And when we multiply that by the negative B out in front, the minus signs cancel. And we end up with an equation for our pressure wave as a function of position and time, BAK sine of KX minus omega T. And that's the big prize that we were after in this video. So now we can precisely describe a sinusoidal pressure wave. In other words, a sound wave where we're playing a pure tone. And one really fast corollary of this result is that we can see the maximum pressure, or the pressure amplitude, is equal to B times A times K. So there's a quick formula for the pressure amplitude of a sound wave, and we're relating the pressure amplitude there, in other words, the max and min pressure relative to atmospheric pressure, to the displacement amplitude A, in other words, the actual physical wiggling of air molecules. So that little formula for pressure amplitude is exactly what we need to work the example on the next slide. So in our example, we're given a pure sinusoidal wave. We're told we have a 300 hertz sound wave, so we're just playing a single pure tone. And we're told the maximum pressure due to this wave is 5 times 10 to the negative 2 pascals. And we're told this roughly corresponds to about 65 decibels. And what we want to find is the displacement amplitude of the air molecules. So how much are they actually wiggling as this sound wave passes through? We're told we can use an approximate speed of sound of 344 meters per second, and we're told the bulk modulus of air is about 1.42 times 10 to the fifth pascal. So using our new formula that relates pressure amplitude and displacement amplitude, we have P is equal to B times A times K. And what we're trying to find here is the displacement amplitude A. So that's going to be a P over B times K. Now we already know the pressure amplitude and we know the bulk modulus. What we need here is the wave number K. So recall that K relates to the wavelength like this. K is 2 pi over lambda, but we weren't directly given the wavelength of this sound wave. Instead, we were given a frequency up here, 300 hertz, and we were given a speed of sound of 344 meters per second. So we go to our wave speed equation. The speed of a wave is frequency times wavelength, and we're going to solve that for the wavelength. That's V over F, and we're going to sub that in to the formula for K. Replacing lambda with V over F gives me a 2 pi F over V, and we're going to replace that K up in our formula for the displacement amplitude, and this gives me a P times V over 2 pi F, and now we can just plug in all the numbers. So our pressure amplitude was 5 times 10 to the negative 2 pascals. I'd rather write that as just 0.05. Our speed of sound, 344 meters per second. We have a 2 pi down there. We have the frequency of our sound wave, 300 hertz. and a bulk modulus of about 1.42 times 10 to the fifth Pascal. And when we run the numbers on this to three significant digits, we get about 6.43 times 10 to the negative eighth meters. And I think it's nicer to express this in nanometers. So this is 64.3 nanometers. So this is a surprising result. A 65 decibel sound is a pretty ordinary sound level. It's just an easily audible sound. And the actual physical wiggling of the air molecules is measured in nanometers. So the amplitude of those oscillations is just incredibly small. In the next video, we cover the intensity of sound waves. In other words, the rate at which energy is delivered per unit area by a sound wave. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left, and I'll see you there.